first stop for the minister was Newcastle's Burwood Beach to check on dune rehabilitation. Since July last year, the community-based dune care group has been working to preserve the area, planting hundreds of trees and constructing fences and walkways. The group supplies the labour, state government the technical advice, and property owners Hunter Water Corporation the materials. With a limited budget, the minister says it's the government's intention for greater community management of community resources.
The community is there in control, and they are the ones who are going to, I think, be able to better look after it than if it's just a government facility.
After contributing to the tree count, the minister moved on to inspect other conservation projects in Newcastle, then flood mitigation works and river catchment management in the Lower Hunter. Tomorrow, Mr. West will tour the Singleton and Muswellbrook areas. Catherine Lamond, NBN News.
Concentrating on maths and spelling can be difficult when you're thinking about your stomach. Principal of Wyong Public School, Bob Ferguson, says a recent survey showed a significant minority of children are going to school without breakfast.
A few families are poor and feel they can't afford breakfast. Most of them who come without breakfast, though, I think come because the parents go to work and think that the children are getting breakfast after they leave, and the children get up late and are in a rush to get here.
Bob Ferguson says the children are lethargic. Consequently, they don't perform to the best of their ability. Nutritionist Rudy Bartell stresses the importance of breakfast. He says children who miss this meal are more likely to have high cholesterol levels.
The foods which we eat for breakfast tend to be low in fat, so breads and cereals, like whatever sort of cereal you prefer, fruit. Some people have vegetables at breakfast, like they might have corn on toast or something like that. They're all really low in fat.
To address the problem, Wyong Public School is set to follow the example of other schools by setting up a breakfast service for students. Jane Anderson, NBN News.
The Morris dancing tradition is said to have originated in Britain thousands of years ago and was brought to Australian shores during settlement. The dance ritual symbolises the rebirthing process after the winter season. The dance is performed to encourage the crops to grow and animals to become fertile. Six boys from Gilgai Public School have learnt to perform the age-old dance, recently taking out the Inverella Stedford. A visiting team of dancers from Brisbane and Toowoomba has assisted the boys with their dancing techniques and also perform with them over the weekend. The professional troupe is impressed with the boys' talents and the fact they're continuing a dying tradition.
Probably because it's fun, it's sort of quite energetic. And we travel quite extensively with it, as you do with a lot of occupations. You sort of tend to turn up in sort of other places or dance with other sides.
You've seen it on TV. You've wondered what on earth they're doing. Well, here's your chance to find out firsthand.
We'll just call it quarterback sneak on one.
Wyoming's brought out 48 high school lads. On Saturday, they take on Utah in a promotional game at Marathon Stadium. There'll be the obvious comparisons between gridiron and our own hallowed brand of footy. The message from Wyoming's head coach John Detai: American football is furious.
We've got those pads on. And those pads a lot of time become weapons as well as protection. And one of the big differences that we see, when one of our guys is running the ball, he's got to keep it. He can't lateral it back, and so then he can be captured or hit by everybody else on the team.
You've never played Utah before. How do you think you're going to fare?
Well, it's going to be real tough for us. Like I say, they've had the opportunity. They've got a smaller group of kids, and they've been able to practice back in the States.
Meanwhile, in another part of town... What would Gridiron be without cheerleaders? Wyoming brought their own. Today they were going through their paces as well. No pom-poms, but plenty of gusto.
Hey, hey, what do you say? W-Y-O.
The game kicks off at 7. Senator Bronwyn Bishop has definite views about the flag and Paul Keating's push to change it.
I think it's arrogance. I really do think it's arrogance. He won't listen to what people have to say, and he's marching on and determined in his own arrogant way.
She believes the Republican movement has been inspired by the Prime Minister as a diversionary tactic.
Well, I think he set out to try and create a diversion, to take people's minds off the fact he'd created the worst recession in 60 years and given us 1 million people who are unemployed.
Senator Bishop says the proposal to change the Australian flag has angered a lot of people.
They love their flag, what it stands for, people are proud to be Australian, and they get very angry when the man who says he's their Prime Minister wants to insult their origins and their national symbols.
With meetings being held all over the Northwest since the passing of the gun legislation in April, gun owners are still no closer to being satisfied with the restrictions. Another meeting has been scheduled in Moree for next Tuesday night, where those opposed to the gun laws can again voice their concern.
We're hoping for a real successful resolution from the floor that we might be able to relay back to the state government to get this legislation withdrawn and maybe amended or whatever it might be.
Spokesman for the meeting, Jim Jukes, says the community has been betrayed, with the government failing to consult them before the gun laws were passed. He says for the men on the land, guns are a way of life.
It's there for some protection. It's a part of your furniture. It's a part of your everyday life, particularly in the bush. And I don't think we can do without it. We should maintain it by all means.
The gear wheel is in two parts. Assembled, it will have a diameter of almost 8 metres. Manufactured at the Ganinans workshop in Newcastle, it represents an important opportunity for Australian industry in Southeast Asia. The tender to build the gear was won against international competition, in particular engineering rivals in the United States. The $500,000 contract was completed on time and will now be delivered to the Kelian Gold Mill in Kalimantan.
It enhances our international reputation. It's already given us opportunities to secure more work, particularly with this customer in Indonesia. We have inquiries from them now.
The company has also won contracts to build smaller components for a cement plant in the Philippines, and it's confident of winning more business in Southeast Asia. The gear wheel will travel overnight by road to Sydney, where it will be shipped to Indonesia via Singapore.
About 11:30 this morning, this horse did more than just bolt. It dashed along Secord Avenue in Dudley, raced down a driveway, through a backyard and found itself flying, quite literally, over a 4-metre rocky cliff. Entangled in thick undergrowth, the horse was galloping nowhere. So in cantered the police, the ambulance rescue squad, the National Parks and Wildlife Service and Lake Macquarie City Council officers. At first, the rescuers looked at winching the horse out, but then decided on the back-breaking option of hacking a path with machetes and chainsaws through the bush and along the ridge. While they had little luck in leading the horse to soft drink, the rescuers did get the mare out of the mire after 3 hours. The rescue teams don't know what the horse is called, but they reckon its name should be Lucky, because despite its fall, it suffered only cuts to the legs. Scott Bevan, NBN News.
On the 28th and 29th of November last year, an unknown quantity of fish was killed in the inlet and outlet channels of Munmorah Power Station. According to Wyong Council and the EPA, the management of the station cleared the dead fish from the channels at night and buried the evidence. The EPA says that initially the incident was denied, but reports from nearby residents and employees of the station confirmed the fish kill had occurred. While all now agree the incident did happen, there are conflicting reports from both Pacific Power Management and the bodies investigating the matter on just how many fish were killed.
It's acknowledged that there was a number of fish killed, but in fact, in the total population of fish, it was very insignificant.
The reports that we have had from reliable sources would indicate about 2 or 3 truckloads were taken away.
Under its licence agreement, Munmorah is required to notify the EPA of any major pollution incident, but that didn't happen.
We didn't get to hear about it until about 3 or 4 days after the event, and we were advised by Wyong Council.
Yesterday, Energy Minister Robert Webster announced a $10 million environmental upgrade at the plant, saying it was part of Pacific Power's ongoing commitment to the environment. However, the EPA claims the work is in fact being done because of considerable pressure from the authority. The EPA is still considering whether to prosecute Pacific Power over the fish incident, but it's been made extremely difficult by the lack of evidence and an uncooperative Munmorah management.
We had very little cooperation, certainly less than we would have had from just about any other licensee in any other circumstance, to my knowledge. Yeah.
At the foothills of the Barrington Tops National Park is the town of Dungog, some 70 kilometres north of Newcastle. It has a population of 2,500. Its forests and associated industries are major employers, second only to education and local council. But that status is under threat. The state government's plan to commercialise the Forestry Commission means Dungog loses its forestry office. 4 employees are to be relocated or offered voluntary redundancy. But Dungog's not alone. 9 other regional or district offices throughout the state are to also close. A necessary step, says Conservation and Land Management Minister Gary West.
I understand that there is some impact, but I have to also be responsible for the good administration of my department. They're not losing their jobs, they're being transferred, and that's what I say. In the country, there is a net loss of only 3 positions.
Dungog and many small towns like it argue that relocation equals a loss.
1 or 2 jobs lost from a town like Dungog, we miss them. We notice they're gone. We miss the income that those jobs bring to the town. 3 or 4 jobs would take from this fragile economy well over $100,000. The economic impact of that loss is significant in a small town.
For Dungog, the forestry office shutdown comes hard on the heels of the closure or downgrading of a number of other government department offices. In the last 2 years, railway station staff have gone, as have those at the telephone exchange. But Dungog isn't alone. The trend, it seems, is representative of the plight of country towns. In Glen Innes, 100 kilometres north of Armidale, restructuring is equally heartfelt.
The town has lost between 80 and 100 public service sector jobs. They go from SRA to forestry to RTA to our court system is in jeopardy as well, and that's a great concern.
The last straw for Glen Innes was the government's reorganisation of the Roads and Traffic Authority. RTA staff in the town is to be cut by 19, approximately 25%. In northern New South Wales, the RTA reshuffle represents a net reduction of 75 jobs, including the amalgamation of five offices into three. Frustrated by what seems endless cutbacks, the Glen Innes business community went on strike last month. Their purpose, to let Premier Greiner know they no longer trust a government whom they believe has forgotten about the country. A plan put forward by Glen Innes to retain its RTA office was rejected by the government last week. In a final-ditch effort, Mr Donnelly has contacted Mr Greiner, requesting he personally consider the situation. Mr Donnelly warns of a backlash at the polls if something isn't done. But what if the situation doesn't change? Research economist Andrew Searles says government restructuring is here to stay. And if small towns want to survive, they must rethink their economic base.
Essentially, I think they have to look at the resources that they've got and looking at ways of capitalising on them.
Catherine Lamond, NBN News.
This is just a sample of what the Will Pigs Fly exhibition deals with concerning genetic engineering, and the exhibition involves the visitor in more ways than one, with the senses of sight, sound and touch being used. There are touch computers and open and shut dioramas on display.
I think the real need is for the community to understand what the technology is, because it is a technology that's going to become more and more part of our lives. And it's a difficult thing to understand.
The aim of the exhibition is to simplify the entire concept of genetic engineering, what it is and what it's doing, also giving the community the chance to have their say. With the technology progressing all the time, farmers in the local area may soon benefit.
In the pipeline at present, a lot of which will benefit Australian farmers. One of particular interest to this locality involves the genetic engineering of cotton, to make it resistant to the cotton bollworm.
But as for getting pigs to fly...
Very unlikely, I would think. For very difficult to do, and why would you want to do it?
After being embarrassed for so long by the appearance of the road, employees at Narrabri's biggest tourist attraction have finally got their way. Work on upgrading the entrance road is proceeding at a cost of $150,000. The bill is being footed by the CSIRO. With more than 15,000 visitors to the telescope every year, including overseas scientists, the people of Narrabri want something done.
In our visitors book in the information centre, there have been a lot of very scathing comments about the quality of the road to our entrance.
The other consideration is safety.
A very large number of people have skidded into the trees on our entrance road in the wet, and we've had two people roll cars in the dry, in the dusty, sandy road.
For some people, being perched precariously as the winter westerlies whip round, well, it's all part of the job. Then there's John Barlow. For him, for the next 40 hours, home is going to be 12 metres up a scissor lift at Stockton. I wondered, who's the stupid one? Him for being there, or me for being up there with him doing a story on him being there? And I wasn't the only one wondering.
Last night, I was having a couple of quiet ales at the RSL, that I was told that I'm mad and... No one could understand why I'd be doing something like this, but there's a lot of people out there a lot worse off than I am.
Aye, there's the rub. You see, by staging this high-altitude hunger strike, John hopes to raise $5,000 for famine relief. I guess it's not so bad. I mean, he's got his telly, his phone, his camp bed. Is this what they mean when they say living it up? And in this chilly weather, I'm betting he'll spend a lot of his time in here. But you see, a life of scissor lift luxury was not John's first choice.
Well, I thought that next time I might do something, we might get a Navy bill and go into the harbour for 40 hours, but of course it wouldn't achieve very much, except that someone would see me go down and come up, hopefully.
Oh dear. Anthony Griffiths, NBN News.
...840 of the region's best high school athletes took time out from the chores of the school curriculum to race uphill and down Dale in the annual secondary cross country. So well was the carnival attended that more than 70 took part in each age group, ranging from 12 years through to the open or 17 years race. Morrisett High's Ansey Sharp and Singleton's Nathan Williams were successful in the 12s, and in the 13s, the same school scooped the pool, and Batterman in the girls and Ben Brooks the boys. To the 14s, and Katara's Amanda Hall joined Tari's Matthew Sada's winners. Melissa and Wayne Bristow of Walls End and Toronto picked up the 15 years age group. The 16 years went to established athletes Catherine Suarez of Katara and Ben Cantillo of Warners Bay. And the open division went to Riley Leslight of Warners Bay and Jackson Pellow of Taree. The winning zone was West Lakes from City and East Lakes. ...600 children from an area bounded by Walgett, Moree, Inverell, Tenafield, Corindai and Dunedoo strode out in bold fashion over a course that provided everyone a chance to excel at some stage during the race, whether it was on the flat riverbank, through a small water hazard or climbing hills. Despite the conditions, there was little time to admire the scenery. It was an all-out effort to finish in the top four in your age group to ensure a place in the team to contest the state titles in July. Some outstanding performances were turned in, especially by Shane Cole of Coolar Central School in the 11 years boys, and Nathan Leese, son of former Western Suburbs League star Jim Leese in the 10 years boys. But the run of the day belonged to champion athlete Kate McMaster of Coolar Central. Kate is the New South Wales Australian and Pacific Games 800 metres champion, and in the cross country, Kate was never headed to record an easy win and confirm her ranking as the best in the state.
But there was something else to celebrate at the New Lambton Uniting Church today, the 100th birthday of Florence Hopkins Cunningham. Born in Wales on June 14, 1892, Florence came to Australia with her husband in 1927. For Florence, it was far from love at first sight with the country she now calls home.
This first Sunday night we were here, my husband's here, I was crying my eyes out. I said, oh love, I'm sorry we came. Listen here, my dear, he said, you won't be sorry. The way you make friends. He said, you'll have half Australia before we know where we are.
Her husband's prediction came true. Friends and family packed the church, including 5 children, 10 grandchildren, 18 great-grandchildren, and 6 great-great-grandchildren from as far away as South Australia. Surrounded by all these people, Florence had something to sing about. In Welsh, of course. Can you let me in on a secret, Florence? How do you live to 100 years old? What have you done right?
Well, I've lived a clean life. I had a few boyfriends, and they were lovely too.
Scott Bevan, NBN News.